All right, welcome everyone to the video. You might wonder, why do I keep taping? Because extraordinary events keep taking place. No question about it. So, today is no different. In fact, it's been amplified many times over. So, I do hope at this time that I am welcome in responsible society. Responsible society is not high society, polite society, you know, all of this other stuff. Responsible society means that you know how to be truly responsible. You've demonstrated true responsibility for a prolonged period of time, made significant breakthroughs. So the first step is to realize what our responsibility is. The second step is to work at that, you know, with great determination for a prolonged period of time. Third step is to actually have some breakthroughs and continue working on that. So I certainly hope, I will see if I'm accepted in responsible society. I certainly need to be, because today I was informed that my work is, there's no work for me, which is on the surface of a catastrophe, many levels, but it's an opportunity also. So we'll see what happens. Let's see if there, I do have a society of a mem- if I'm a member of responsible society, in which case certainly there something will come to help me. There's all sorts of support groups in this world in general that support people that are part of their culture, their family, their society, etc. There's ways to help. And so I don't belong to any of those support groups at all, except I hope responsible society. Those who know what need to be done, and who are getting it done. Now I have reason for hope, because recently I've been able to get an actual glimpse of the vision of oneness, which is extremely significant, and also been able to develop spiritual practices that help lead us to the vision of oneness, and that's also very significant. But I'm not entirely comfortable yet in those roles. I'm not comfortable in the role of teaching, or you know, any of that. That takes some time to get comfortable in such a situation. Not there yet. Want to get there for sure, but that takes some very, very supportive situation. Also, I've been able to see through. Today I just saw through entirely the ego's sleight of hand, the sleight of hand that's taking place here in this world. I've commented on it in many, many, many videos, but today was very crystal clear in its most essential format. And that is rarely accomplished here. Just to completely see the sleight of hand for what it is. Very, very difficult to see that. But, you know, we'll see. We'll see. I don't really know how things will go. But I do know there's a coming Inquisition in this world. It is Inquisitional time, and I do know I would certainly be a prime target for the Inquisition. So, of course, I'm going to take refuge from that if that becomes possible, for sure. What the ego wants to do is it wants to eliminate any option other than what it's presenting. What is the ego presenting? It's presenting this. It's saying, look, truth has no place for lies in it, right? We say in reality there's no place for lies. And the ego says that is greater than God. Why? Because the ego says, you know what? Lies can make room for truth within lies. Lies will make room for truth. Huh? Yeah. And so the ego says, we're more tolerant in this kingdom of lies. We have a greater tolerance than the reality has. We're greater than God. We're more tolerant than God. And so the ego says that it's working on this, it's working to figure out a way, it's evolving a way of including truth within lies. Of course, this is another lie. But it's very difficult to see through this because the ego says, well, we're working on it. We haven't succeeded yet, but we're working on it, and we'll get there. So it's kind of like a future promise that somehow within the kingdom that is nothing but a lie, somehow there's going to be room to include truth in that also. That is what the ego tells us. Now, the ego goes through various cycles, this effort, this so-called evolution into something greater than reality. And it has different management teams in place during these different cycles. Now, when a cycle changes, what happens, when it means cycle change, it means a new management team is brought into the picture. And what the ego says to this new management team, it points out to the old one. What it does, it scapegoats the old management team and says, look, you can see that we have a lot of problems here and we haven't succeeded yet. Why? Hint, the ego doesn't admit what it's trying to do. What it's trying to do is impossible. Oh, no, no, no. It says, why have we not succeeded yet? It says, because this old management team was lazy, was self-centered, was actually wicked, was trying to undermine this purpose, and was extremely incompetent, and even criminally incompetent. So, the first order for business for you new management team that you're taking over, one, you're taking over because I know that you can do the job. I know you can do the job. You're special. You're special. You have special characteristics. You have sort of an intuitive, natural sense of how to get this job done, how to include truth within lies. So your first order of business is to make that old management class pay for their sins, for their extreme negligence and criminal incompetence, and making things so difficult for you. So there's no punishment that is extreme enough for them, that they've left you with this mess. How unbelievably terrible of them. So you're completely within your rights to subjugate them, to enslave them, and to get them to work on all the most terrible, difficult tasks, slave labor tasks. Whatever you tell them to do, you are absolutely within your right without any feeling of compassion for them whatsoever. After all, what kind of compassion did they have for you? Look, they didn't hand you success, did they? No. So the new management class comes in and they have an inquisitional, the ego has given them an inquisitional mindset where they get to hunt down all those that from the old management team and make an example of them and give them the worst terrible jobs possible and make them strip them of all authority, all power, debase them, humiliate them, and eliminate them. This inquisitional mindset. Now, this is where we're at right now. Fast forward to the end of this, the next cycle. This cycle is now starting, a new cycle is now starting. Then when this one comes to an end, what does the ego do? Exact same thing. Brings in a new management team and says the exact same spiel to the new management team. Says, look at the mess that's here. Look at the failure that's here. Is that a failure of purpose? Does that mean we can't do it? Absolutely not. It means that this old management team got lazy, they got selfish, and they're criminally negligent. And they're the reason why this plan is failing. They're the reason. They're the only reason. So you got to crack down on them as hard as possible. You know, clear the decks, clean slate, and you're special, and you can succeed. Same story. Fast forward again at the end of that cycle. New cycle coming in. Ego says the same thing. New management team, same thing. It goes on and on and on and on, just like this, just like this. So I've seen through it. I've seen through the ego's sleight of hand, and I'm seeing how most of us in this world don't see through it, actually. And what's happened is the old management team is realized they're whipped. They're on the out, and they're frantically scrambling to bow to the new management team and desperately trying to get a position there. It's something, you know, they just say, okay, whatever you want, whatever you want, whatever you want. There's some, well, this is what's happening. There's some like myself who sees this through the sleight of hand and says, no. The problem is not what management team you have in place. The problem is the goal that you're pursuing is completely impossible. Because truth completely cancels out lies. And lies completely deny truth. The idea that you can half deny truth is a complete denial of truth. It is a complete denial of truth. All lies are forever lies. All lies are complete lies. Okay. All lies are complete lies. So having seen through the sleight of hand, I'm no longer in a position of vulnerability like I would be if I was the part of the old management team. And I'm just thinking, wow, I guess we really screwed up. Well, you know, we're guilty. We're terrible. We're guilty. What can we do to help, you know? Oh, accept our enslavement and slave labor. Okay. We deserve it. We deserve it. Mea culpa. We deserve it. I'm not part of that at all. All I see, I was completely duped the whole time. Completely duped. But what is the old management team was what we call the patriarchy. It was male-based, okay. And I did my utmost to try and uplift the world through that management team. But you don't do it through high culture. That's, you know, that's not the answer. Enlightenment is the answer. Seeing through the ego sleight of hand is the answer. Right spiritual practice is the answer. The vision of oneness is the answer. Not beautiful music. Beautiful music isn't the answer. So I did everything I could. And so, you know, now I realize I was just, you know, completely duped by this sleight of hand. And so I'm, you know, definitely on the outs, not being part of the new management team at all. The new management team is the matriarchy. Is the matriarchy, is the feminist, really extraterrestrial alliance, but we can say it's the feminist matriarchal management team, but they're actually in cahoots with extraterrestrials. That's the new management team, and they have come in and basically they have laid down the law, that basically their motto is zero tolerance, zero tolerance. Now, we've seen this before in this world many times over. Inquisitions have taken place. New management teams come in and on smaller scales. And basically what they do is they target the old management, and then they have these mock trials where they use any pretext whatsoever to convict them and off to the gulag or off to the auto de fe, burned at the stake. You don't have a chance. You don't have a chance. And those who do carry out the Inquisition don't have any twinge of conscience or compassion whatsoever. What they're saying is, look what the mess you left us with. Look how difficult our job is now because of you. Because of you. You're the one that's causing me all the strain and stress and misery of having to pick up the pieces from your criminal negligence. And even you worked against this. You even worked against it. So you death is a minor punishment for you is how they look at it. A very minor punishment. You deserve way worse than death is how they believe. They believe that. And of course, the old management team just throws up their hand and say, you know, we did the best we could. We had an impossible job. You know, we weren't criminally negligent. We did the best we could. But the fact is we couldn't succeed. So of course we get lazy and run down, etc. And you will suffer the same fate too. Absolutely, they say to the new management class. And of course, the new management class doesn't believe that. They bought the ego sleight of hand, hook, line, and sinker. Hook, line, and sinker. And I can see that crystal clear in this world. The new management class, they have absolutely bought into what the egos told them. Why? Ambition, spiritual pride, grandiosity, desire to be prime creator than God. And they see, imagine, they feel like, oh my gosh, we get to be the new management class. We get to be the authority in this world. We get to tell everybody else what to do. We're going to succeed where you failed. And this is a very heady wine that they're drinking, actually. And they've lost their heads over it. You might say they're in an extremely drunken state of hearing the ego's flattery. They're drunk on the ego's flattery, that where the old management class totally fail, they are going to have this incredible success. Just wait and see what amazing things they can do once they get the power, once they tell everybody what to do, get everybody working, they're going to fix everything. They're going to fix it all because they have some special inborn, innate capacity to do it simply for because of their gender, you know, and they can't help but succeed. And that their success, that this evil, this other management style was so evil and wicked that they didn't even see what the ones who really could do the job, they suppressed them and they repressed them and they kept them from succeeding. So now they're going to be liberated and all their potential will be liberated so they'll be able to succeed where the other failed. This is the spiel the ego gives every new management class. They pump them up, motivational speaker-like style, you know, like, you guys are the greatest. You guys are the unbelievably greatest. You're going to succeed. Total BS. Total lies. The goal is impossible. Totally impossible. You cannot, lies cannot include truth within lies at all. This is utter delusion. It's total whimsicality. So there's zero chance that this new management class is going to succeed. It's zero chance. There's no chance at all. None. It will be a complete failure, like all management classes have been a complete failure. The only success that comes is, of course, by those who are from responsible society, those who come in and help out in spite of the madness here on this planet. And you cannot ascribe that success to the management team at all. No. You ascribe that success to the grace of God. That's the only success that there is from the grace of God. There is no other success. And the grace of God is not male, the grace of God is not female, the grace of God is not some management team in that way at all. Sure, there are those who, you know, are part of that effort. But it's really coming from God. It's coming from truth. It's coming from truth. And of course, those who believe that truth can be included in lies are believing a lie. They're not part of truth. They're not accepting truth at all. No such thing as half truths. All lies are total lies. All lies are total lies. So, with that, all of that said, you know, it's not possible to withstand the new management class and try to prevent them from taking over. They've already taken over. So what I've seen is God saying you need to get out of the way because you're not yet totally comfortable, which is true. I'm not totally comfortable in the vision of oneness and teaching, right, spiritual teaching. I'm just easing into it, but I'm not. You have to be perfectly comfortable with it in order to handle this transitional time, because it's going to be a very, very bad time. For some, it'll seem like a great triumphant time. And for the losers, a very bad time. You know, those who are getting sacked on the way out, it's going to be a hellacious time for sure. And so, what I've been told is, stay out of it. You know, you're not competent yet to handle such a situation. And that is absolutely true. Absolutely true. I am not competent enough at this point. No way. No way. Someday I will be. Maybe the next cycle, turnover times, I'll be competent at that time. That is possible. Or at some phase down the road here, in the near future, I might be competent enough. I don't know how it'll go. But at this point right now, I'm not. So another factor of getting entry into responsible society is humility. That's probably the most important one. The mood of repentance and humility, recognizing you're not aggrandizing yourself. I've seen the vision of oneness. I see very well that I've got quite a ways to go before I'm completely comfortable with it, for sure, because it's so totally profound. No words need to be said because it's completely self-evident, totally self-evident, without necessity of any thought or words whatsoever. You have to get accustomed to that. going beyond words. Why? Because it's totally self-evident. You don't need any words. Nothing needs to be added or subtracted. Always present. You don't need to remember it. It's always present. Don't need to form concepts about it. Don't need to elaborate upon it. Nothing needs to be said about it because it's just flawless, it's perfect, and it's here now, and it extends forever, and completely self-evident, totally. So there isn't any need for words whatsoever. You can still speak, but you know there's absolutely no necessity for words. It's just you can, as a pragmatic convention, you can speak. So getting comfortable with that, I'm sure that takes some doing for sure. That's why you see the yogis in the caves. You know, they're getting used to it. They're getting used to this vision of oneness about which nothing needs to be said. Totally self-evident. Completely self-evident. Entirely self-evident. Everything. All is one. All is one. All is one. What needs to be said? What else needs to be said? So, what happens next? I don't know. I do not know. I had a horrible dream last night. I was woken up at 3 in the morning by this terrible nightmare. Somehow, I went to the doctor's office and they said, do we need to take a closer look at something? And they said, here, can you lie down here? And then suddenly the doctor says, okay, we need to operate immediately. And I said, what? And they said, yeah, we're going to do brain surgery on you. I said, whoa, wait a minute. And they started to prep me for brain surgery. I said, hey, wait, what's going on here? This seems too radical, seems too immediate. And I started fighting with the doctor. I said, no. He says, I don't feel right about this. What's going on? I just came in for just a talk, and now you're ready to put me under and cut my head open, you know, and do brain surgery. What? And no, I won't put up with this. And then another doctor came in. They brought some, like, the chief doctor in. It's very smooth guy. What the first doctor told me was that I'm not going to be able to keep my balance for the next three years. The brain surgery is going to affect my ability to keep my balance. So I said, I can't work then. If I don't have my balance, how can I work? I can't drive. I can't work. I got to support my family. I can't agree to that. I can't agree to it. Then the chief surgeon came in and said, look, there is this problem with the balance, and it is necessary and important, and kind of had a talk with the chief surgeon, which didn't go over that well either. But I woke up just shaking at 3 in the morning. It's just kind of a nightmare that just brings you out of your sleep in a shock. You know, radical brain surgery. For what? So I don't have any problem. I don't have any problem with my brain. So, now, I don't know what that dream was talking about exactly. I think, because I've always been told, don't take it personally. These dreams that I have, they relate to the world. I've always been told, relate them to the world, not yourself. Okay, so I would say, in looking at this, I would say there's going to be a very rapid decline in this world as the new management team decides to start their zero tolerance policy. The motto is, this year's going to be year of action. Count on it. And that they're going to do is they're going to do radical surgery on the brain of this planet, as it were. Okay, radical surgery. and they're going to change the fundamental operating system, the fundamental valuing system, and they're going to put their system in place, and it's going to be 3 years. It's going to be very chaotic here on this planet for 3 years. It'll take about 3 years to work through the chaos, to significantly work through it. I would say, of course, there's going to be lasting imbalance and troubles here, but there's going to be a period of radical surgery taking place, and then extreme troubles adapting to it. Severe side effects from the surgery, radical surgery, lasting 3 years. Now, what I saw is people on this planet, men in particular, are going to say, no, we don't want this, as they see themselves being stripped of all respect, all authority, all respect, and basically labeled as, you know, criminals, severe criminals, with a complete stigma upon their souls, like an eternal stigma on their souls, an inferior underclass, a slave class type of thing. So of course they're going to say, hey, we don't want this, we don't want this. Now the fact that I've been able to see through the sleight of hand the ego's up to means, you know, I'm in a different situation. Can look at it objectively. Now, of course, there's a lot of women who say, whoa, wait a minute. I don't want to be part of any effort to try and accomplish the impossible. That's just a waste of my time. I don't care if the ego tells me that because I'm a woman, somehow I'm intuitively, naturally capable to accomplish the impossible. I know that's a lie. It's a lie. And I'm going to be, eventually, it's going to happen. What's happening to the patriarchy, the males, it's going to happen to me too if I get involved in that. I'm going to get crushed. The ego's going to crush me too, which it definitely will. Definitely will, because it'll be a complete failure. So I don't want to waste my time with that. Absolutely not. I'm not buying it. I am not buying it. So both men and women at this time will say, no, we're going to take refuge. We're going to take refuge from this ego sleight of hand. We're going to get comfortable with right spiritual practice, which is easy. I've just shown many videos recently. It's easy. We can do it. Anyone can do it. I have a continuity problem. Bingo. That's the start. I have a severe continuity problem. That's my only problem. The vision of oneness resolves the continuity problem. Only the vision of oneness has value. Nothing else has value. So once you see the ego's sleight of hand, you don't need to stick around and see how the new management team does. You already know how it ends. It ends poorly. It always does. There's no possibility, none, that they can succeed. Doesn't matter how they go about it. Guaranteed failure. You cannot include truth within lies. You cannot include lies within truth. Truth is true, and lies are forever lies. Truth is totally true, and lies are totally lies. Lies are totally false. All lies are totally false. All truth is totally true. This is all you need to know. That's all anyone needs to know. So there's no point in paying the slightest attention to this, what's going on in the management and all this stuff. It's nothing. Nothing is happening. So why invest your effort, time and effort doing nothing when you could be doing right spiritual practice and literally moving into abidance in the vision of oneness, which I guarantee you there is no experience that can touch it as far as saying, when you see it, you say, that's exactly what I really want. No question about it. Everything else, you just forget about it. Right? Forget about it. It's exactly what you really want. And you feel it. You feel it's like glow. You feel it's glow. Like you're radiating. You feel like you're radiating this tremendous glow, a presence of there's not really even a word for it. You have to experience it. You can say just this beautiful richness, you know, this beautiful richness. But that doesn't, you can't capture it in words, really. But you are, you feel like you are forever accepted, you know, forever accepted. You belong. You belong. You forever, this feeling of total belonging. You're radiating this feeling of just, I totally belong. And everyone totally belongs. That's getting closer to it, you know. I totally belong. There's no way I can ever not belong. And the same with everything. Everything totally belongs to this just one flawless, beautiful acceptance, you know. Just, it's like that. And you feel like you're glowing with that sense of feeling that you belong, you really belong. Everything as it is totally belongs, as it is, without the slightest modification in any way whatsoever. Everything totally belongs right now. And you're experiencing that. Completely independent of any judgment whatsoever. You are not judged at all. Nothing is judged. Everything is totally judgment-free. Totally judgment-free. And you radiate this sense of this totally free of all judgment. And you literally are aware and feeling. You have a feeling that you belong. It's a feeling. It's an awareness of feeling. It's obvious. So that is what we really want. That is what we really want. This stupid, you know, man, sleight of hand the ego's engaged in. Is that it? Is that the way the vision of oneness, which is right now, is that it? No, it's not. Is it right spiritual practice? No. The ego always says, oh, but we'll get to that. We'll get to that. Really? It never gets to it. It never gets to it. Because its goal is to say it's greater than God, and its goal is to include truth within lies. So it says, well, of course we'll get to that eventually, because we're going to succeed, we're evolving towards that. And eventually, if you just follow the advice of this management team, you're going to get there. And then you will certainly do right spiritual advice, right practice, and you'll get the vision of oneness for sure, whatever you want. That'll be included too in this new kingdom we're making, where, of course, all lies are also totally worshipped. Also, you see, this is complete whim, nothing but whim. There's no reason there whatsoever, actually. It is all whimsical. And what can you say to someone who's in complete whim? What can you say that can change their mind? They're not in a state of reason. They're not in the right mind at all. They're not in the right mind. They're in a state of whimsy. I don't know how I could possibly do any better seeing through the sleight of hand of the ego like this, recognizing how this, the chain of existence, this terrible prison camp of existence, really, is a prison camp, to make no mistake about it. It's a slave labor prison camp. It's really, there are no words that can describe how terrible it is, actually, and go on and on and on and on and on. It's a ghastly misery. It is a continuing, non-stop holocaust. It is a self-devouring nightmare, actually. And yet, we keep falling for it over and over and over. That's a tragedy. That is a tragedy. But I couldn't stop it. I couldn't stop it. Nobody could stop it. Nobody stopped it. Because it's our will. It's our will that this take place. Because we keep thinking that we're going to get it. we're going to succeed. We just don't have the right management team in place. We're just not, you know, cracking the whip appropriately, not following the right orders, and somehow disobeying orders. No, we're not disobeying orders. We're doing what the ego tells us to do. The fact is that what the ego tells us to do doesn't work. And the goal is impossible to reach. So we have to forgive ourselves because we weren't negligent. We didn't fail and stuff like that. We're simply attempting to do what is impossible to do. And of course, feeling like totally beaten and defeated, and eventually you slide into just, you know, various states that defeat and futility bring about. The attempt to accomplish, you know, the impossible, the futility, of course, that's going to just wipe you out. And you're going to act in all sorts of ways that you think, wow, I'm not being very responsible. How can we act in a responsible manner in our efforts to accomplish the impossible? It's not possible. Because responsible manner means you're doing what is necessary to succeed, to be effective. And there is no way to succeed. So you can't possibly do what's necessary to succeed. It doesn't matter what management team you're under, you cannot succeed. So why say mea culpa? You're not guilty. You're not guilty of obstruction. Nobody's guilty of obstruction. The vision of oneness is not obstructed by anything, by any failure at all. It's not obstructed at all. It's right now, present, completely present right now. Never any obstruction of it. Never any obstruction of truth. Truth is completely unobstructed. So forgive yourself. That's another way to get in. You have to get into responsible society. Forgive yourself. Stop saying mea culpa. And stop worshiping the idols of the new management team. The new management team idols. We're supposed to idolize them. Yeah. And you know what I'm talking about. I mean, you get those who have been brought up the new management team, which is, again, it's feminine. It is matriarchal based. To distinguish it from the previous one, which was patriarchal based, these people automatically assume that they're going to go to the very highest institution in the world. And you say, well, you know, really, what, why? Because I'm great. Of course, I'm entitled to it. I'm intrinsically, inherently entitled to the very best because I'm part of this new management. So of course I'm entitled to it. It doesn't even cross their mind, they're not, you know, that you might have to be, you know, qualified or something. They say, no, I'm inherently qualified. So they have this mindset that they're inherently great. That's a given. So it's just simply a given that they should be welcomed into the highest echelons of power in this world and in authority without being questioned at all, Now, if you talk to a guy like that, can you get into, they'd say, are you kidding? Are you crazy? I can't get in there, not have a ghost of a chance. I'd have to be like the best of the best of the best of the best of the best. And even if I was that, there'd be thousands who are better than me. You know, so it's just ridiculous to even think that way. But not for the new management class. Brush that aside. That's nothing. It's nothing. No. I'm entitled to it. No questions asked. No doubts need be raised. To raise any doubt is wickedness. It's evil. Right? They've totally bought into this inquisitional mindset. Hey, you see it? It's unbelievable. The princess complex. And they've been taught that men's opinion is, male opinion is completely worthless. Completely worthless. They don't even need to listen to it at all. Nothing but a pack of lies. Nothing but the voice of failure. You know, it's the ego projecting its advice onto the male and say, look, that's where the failure is. Not the ego, it's the man who's the voice of failure, not the ego. It tells them the ego's the voice of success. It just the men didn't listen properly. They started talking about the Holy Spirit or listening to some other voice. Of course, that's why two different advices, and the one doesn't know what they're talking about. They said the Holy Spirit says that truth is true and only truth is true, and that's a lie. The fact is that both lies and truth can be true. We're tolerant. We have this great tolerance. We have this ability to form consensus and groups and all that kind of stuff. And so, of course, when the men say, hey, wait a minute. We've been through all this, and I guarantee you, you're getting duped. They don't listen to that at all. They say, no, you listen to the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit doesn't know how to include both lies and truth. But the ego, it knows how to do it. And it knows that it's going to tell us how. And we're going to be your savior. You know, we're going to be a savior. So you need to stick around so you can experience being saved. No, you'll experience being crushed. That is the trickery that's going on. That's the sleight of hand that is literally taking place. That's what's going on. And I'm not saying this so I have a high place somewhere. I know the vision of oneness. You see equal place. Everything has equal place. And that's what you really want to see. That is the high place. Is to see that there's everything without exception, just as it is, just as it ever could be or ever was or could be, has this total belonging. Perfect, total belonging forever. As it is, forever. So that's not a question of someone trying to finagle something. No. It won't be listened to, for sure. Except for some exceptions, of course. They don't want to delay. You don't want to delay for another cycle. Why? It's just the same old, same old. Bottom line, misery. Of course, there's repackaging taking place. Massive repackaging. What's inside the package? Misery. And misery is miserable. For sure. You can't just name it something else and think it's not going to be miserable. It is going to be misery. These egoic cycles are nothing but misery. At best, that's the best you can say about it. You might say total misery, really. And of course, the feeble hope is that maybe you'll be elevated to some high manners and position, and that's why you'll find your happiness. You'll have your castle on the hill, and everybody will bow down to you, to your authority, to your power, and say, oh, we need to do what you tell us because we know that somehow you've been invested with the secret of how to succeed, so please tell us. We'll just do whatever you want to do. You turn into zombies, you know, you turn into idolaters. And that's miserable. Being an idolater is miserable. Absolutely miserable. I don't care who you're bowing and scraping to. The one you can trust is the Holy Spirit, because the Holy Spirit will guide you only to the vision of oneness, which is perfect equality, perfect equal belongingness. Totally, everything equally belongs. Totally belongs. Absolute belonging. Right here, right now, as it is. That's what the Holy Spirit will lead you to. This infinite sense of belonging in an infinite universe of everything else totally belonging. All right now, all without any effort on your part, without any effort on the part of any management team to make it so. The only management team that you could talk about is those who help you wake up from your coma, so that you can see that without any effort on anyone's part, This is so. With no effort, this is so. With no effort, this is so. With no effort, this is so. You can say that. Without any effort, this is so. Absolute belonging. This is so. Without any effort, this is so. But until we get perfect comfort with this, there have to be rules. There has to be proper support. You know, and you're in a vulnerable, fragile condition because the ego is screaming at you that you're bigoted, that you're biased, you're intolerant, you're refusing. You know, you're backward, you're ignorance, and just every terrible, malodorous type of accusation aimed at you. And ultimately, you're evil, you're intransigent, you're wicked, you know, and you need to be destroyed. Because it insists that you're willfully trying to interfere with its greatness, with its potential. So the ego projects its potential, what it thinks its potential, onto its new management class and says, if you don't do what they say, you're hindering them, their potential. You're keeping them from reaching their potential. How awful of you. How awful of you. But the ego's really saying you're keeping the ego. The truth is somehow keeping the ego from reaching its potential, which it claims is to include both truth and lies in the same place, as it were. As one. Truth and lies as one. Denying reality. God, of course. So, these are the lies the ego tells, and they're difficult lies too for anyone to withstand, because you feel like you're an oddball. You don't fit in at all here in the world. So anyway, the Holy Spirit is up to the plate. You know, it's up to bat. I got the word today that there's no work. And potentially catastrophic for my life, for sure, and for those who depend on me, absolutely. So the ego's up to bat. And certainly I'm not going to help out the new management team. Actually, the new management team has offered me to help them out. You know, they said, hey, you know, you can help in this transition. Well, you're a transitional figure. You can help in this new transition to the new cycle and help us out and stuff. Well, I thought, well, yeah, at first I thought, well, yeah, maybe that's good, when I was still deceived by this. And gradually I started realizing, well, wait a minute, I'm just being used. There's no place for me in this at all. They're just using me and then just going to discard me. And they don't really have not really teaching the truth. And I started really seeing, had reservations, seeing like, whoa, what is going on here? This something's really not right. What's going on? And then so as gradually with incredible effort have been working, you know, to see the sleight of hand of the ego. That's what's really going on here. But for sure, there were strong attempts to get me to help in the transition, because I had the capacity to speak with authority on spiritual matters, and they thought if I did that, and I said, hey folks, you need to trust this new management team, I can vouch for them, that would greatly help them, you know. But obviously I saw through the scam. It was a scam. But they certainly haven't listed some. I mean, there's a lot out in the world, a lot, you know, saying, hey, welcome the new management team. These are the ones that are going to get it done, folks. You can trust in them entirely, implicitly. Come on, they've got it. There's the natural capacity to do it. And we all need to circle the wagons and make it simple, and those who really do know how to accept the vision of oneness, well, they just don't fit in. We just can't listen to them at this time, and you know, got to move on here, and let's get on the same page. Let's get into our zero tolerance meditation here, where we're going to make sure that nobody expresses any other option or opinion other than the one that we're told to accept. And if we all just get on the same page, all pull in the same direction, with no resistance whatsoever, then for sure we must be able to succeed. Who cares what the goal or purpose is? The means will make the ends possible. Really. So the means we're using to make both lies and truth true, or include truth within lies, the means to do that is means that is possible. It means that so that means that the means we use to overthrow God and reality make it possible. Does God agree with that? Holy Spirit says God doesn't agree with that. So, I mean, where do we get it that God agrees with that? And we don't need God's agreement? I mean, God doesn't matter what God's will is? It doesn't matter? God's will we just throw in the trash? It doesn't matter anymore because we've used means to make it, to get rid of it? That's what the ego says. We just use the means long enough and the God's will is certain to crumble. Is that God's will, that God's will crumbles if certain means are used? Is that it? Holy Spirit says, no. That's total delusion, total whimsicality. So we decide for ourselves, is that whimsical or is it true? You know, it's a lie. It's another lie. The ego was born of a lie. All it does is lie. All it does is, but it has no, what do you say, uncertainty about its lies, really. That's what sort of like unnerves us, because the ego is so confident that it's right, it's lies, because that's all it knows. That's all it knows. It's not conflicted because it simply was born of conflict. So it's comfortable within conflict. It's comfortable within lies. When it's lying, it feels that it's fulfilling its purpose, its goal, right? So it just keeps on lying. It's up to us to see through the lies, because we're the ones that gave birth to these lies by wanting to be greater than God. And of course, up to us, we need to take the right pragmatic steps, which is to listen to the Holy Spirit, to pay attention to the reasoning that it shares with us. And says, look, that you can reason this through, you can see it. Reasoning is a type of seeing, type of spiritual seeing, actually. And you can see through the ego's sleight of hand how it keeps these cycles going and keeps us bewildered. Now, of course, I've talked to many men, and they all know that it's curtains for them. And what do, they just shrug their heads and just, well, you know, it's like, you know, gotta do what they say, gotta do what the new boss says, you know, gotta do what they say. They don't have any options. They don't see any option except to capitulation. Adulation, idolatry. Like, well, of course. We're terrible. I mean, we're really awful. I mean, we're so terrible. Of course, we're gonna do what they say. I mean, we're idiots. We completely screwed it up. So of course we're gonna do what they say. Well, of course, there's no other option. It's obvious we're gonna do that. They overlooked the fact that they were given an impossible task, and continue to be given an impossible task. And they think that just the suffering and contrition and punishment that they get is somehow going to make it possible, you know, remove the block that was blocking it. So see, the idea of the ego believes in punishment. If you just punish the evildoers, then the block, that which was blocking us from accomplishing this goal of including truth within lies, will be removed through punishment, through sacrificing those who stood in the way. And that's what the ego tells us, and we believe it. So of course we're going to carry out sacrifice. That's why they sacrificed Jesus. This is what stood in the way. Truth is what stood in the way. This is the evildoer, the one who is intransigent, who only sees truth, and only truth is true. That's odd. Well, there you have it. There's the one who's preventing us from succeeding. Get rid of this one, sacrifice them, and that should work. The ego says that should work, and so you just have to. And the ego says, just get used to it. If you just get used to the fact that we're able to kill truth, get rid of truth, then the one who believed in truth will say, then we just have to get used to it, and eventually, once we get used to it, we'll succeed. Just you know, it's just a matter of getting used to it. So the ego believes that punishment makes lies true, or makes the goal of lies being able to include truth within the lie, as if lie is primary and truth is the display, is part of the display that is included within lies. That's like saying thingness is primary and spaciousness is included within the realm of thingness. It's upside down and backwards. Even more than that, it's a whimsy, total whimsy. The kingdom of truth is totally true. There's no lie whatsoever there, never will be. And the so-called imaginary kingdom of lies is nothing but lies. There's no, truth cannot be included within that. Wherever there is truth or light comes into the world, the darkness is dispelled. Darkness is dispelled. The lie is seen through and rejected as a lie because it's not true. So, it's going to be an interesting time. I have to inform people, hey, you know, not going to be getting sufficient money and stuff, and I don't know how that'll go. But again, that's only the way the ego sees it. So from my standpoint, I expect something, you know, very helpful to occur. I can't see it otherwise. Meanwhile, I'll keep on working on clarification, of course. And of course, help understanding that, and certainly need help, because there's still that comfort, old comfort, with this idea of projected will, and how you're supposed to, there's some will stronger than you that forces you into accepting the ego's advice and going off the ego's advice and forcing you to be crushed when the ego says you should be crushed, etc. Be sacrificed when the ego says you need to be sacrificed. There's still that comfort level with that. And the comfort level with the vision of oneness is still very, you know, iffy. So, of course, I need help, and everybody in this world needs help, for sure. It's just where do you turn to help for? Most of us turn to the ego and say, hey, get me back to my old comfort zone, you know, of accepting my fate according to your design. And most of us choose that. But I'm trying to choose, no, bring me into the new comfort zone of right spiritual practice and accepting the vision of oneness. Very doable. I'm sure it's doable. I don't know how long it would take. But it's doable. So the Holy Spirit works in very mysterious ways as far as it, how does it, I don't know how, I don't have a clue how it's going to manage things. It's the ultimate manager. It's the real management class of the whole, you know, that knows how to bring us, solve the continuity problem. So I'll just have to find out what it's going to do, what the Holy Spirit's going to do. But I can't tell you what it's going to do because, again, it's always... has some humor to what it does, actually. It does stuff in a way that you just have to shake your head and chuckle and laugh and just say, wow, I couldn't have figured that one out. Didn't have that one figured out, that is for sure. So some of you may find yourself in my shoes at some point, or maybe you already have, or you're in the same shoes at this time. So it's always good to share this and then see a positive outcome for it, for sure. Positive outcome, great outcome. All right, and so I'll keep taping if I can and see how it goes. Very great. Thanks for watching. That's it for this one.